Hello and welcome. I'm Dr. Abstract, this little fellow right here. And in this video, we're going to show you how to get an animation with a sprite onto your web page, your website. And specifically, we'll be using the Zim JavaScript Canvas framework. And this page itself can be found at zimjs.com/IA for interactive animation. Because we're not going to only put the animation on the website like that, but we're going to show you how to make an interactive animation as well. So here's an example down here where we have a space guy and he's walking, and note that we can use the mouse to change his direction or press on mobile, and we can go faster or slower, and we can shoot. And this will shoot a random number of times. That was three times in behind there. Like it. And there's also music. So we'll show you how to create this example where the backgrounds are also scrolling at different speeds to form parallax. Okay, let's go back then to the top. So this is a sprite, and a sprite is made from sprite sheets. So an animator, perhaps you're an animator, that would be great. You would make a bunch of pictures, an animation from a bunch of pictures, and export those pictures. You would then import those pictures into Texturepacker. This is the pro version of Texturepacker, which is about $60 to buy. I think you get 5 free ones or something. But here's a free version right here. So we'll click here. So you would upload your images by dropping them on here or hitting add sprites. And then it will make a page like this for you, a PNG that you can download and a data file that you can download. So what it does is it packs those pictures into one thing called a sprite sheet. It looks something like that. We've made a simple example right here that takes that sprite sheet that you just saw and turns it into a Zim sprite sheet, like so. So we're going to go through and take a look at the code that can do that. Before we do that, though, we want to see where will we put this code. A little bit of an intro as to where we'll be coding. That, by the way, is something like the code right there that shows that sprite sheet. There's the PNG, here's a JSON file. And then we make a new sprite where we're saying what JSON file to use. We center it and we run that sprite 3.5 seconds. We rewind and loop. Okay, so that's the idea, and we want to go see that code. But before we do, if we scroll on down here, we have some resources. One is the zip, and I'll take you through the zip. There's a video, that's this video, and you're welcome to ask any questions on Discord or Slack. If you have a problem, we'll show you those at the end of the video as well. Here's the Learn section, that's where I want to go now, and take a look at just sort of how we begin all of this stuff. And if you want to do even more, if you want to end all that stuff, make a career of it, then you're welcome to join us at Sheridan in Interactive Media, where I teach, and you can click that to find out more about that. We'll hit the Learn section right here. Whoop. Or you could have hit the Learn section across the top, right there. All we need is a computer, a web editor or an editor, and then a browser, and you're happy. So we'll be using Atom. And you can press on any of these to get them. They're free and fast, easy to get. VS Code, Notepad++, Sublime, etc. So that's great. In this Learn section, though, there's a place where you can type online without even getting an editor, and we let the kids do that. We also have a lab that lets you do online for more grown-ups, maybe, but kids are fine. You're just learning, so why not? And lots of videos and support about all of this stuff, CodePen support. Okay, so much more. There's Sheridan, where I teach, and articles about how to begin, as well as a slew of tutorials. Okay, so back up. We want to go to the editor now, so I'll just pop on back to there. And we're going to be taking a look at that one simple example. All right, so we'll reduce this down. Here's the editor. This is Adam, And we're in an HTML page. We're importing Zim right here from this location. This has some information about making a sprite sheet. So we talked a little bit about it. You go to Texturepacker. You would import all of your pictures there. If you're an animator and you've made a bunch of pictures, you import them. And then just use the settings that are already set, and you export the PNG and JSON, and that will come, that will be downloaded to your computer. You want to then add them into an assets folder in the same directory as your HTML page. So this is the index HTML page that we're working in here. Here's the assets directory right here, and we put the spritesheet.json and the spritesheet.png in there. There's the PNG that got downloaded of those four pictures of the animation. Here's the sprite sheet that says where those pictures are on the sprite sheet, where they've been packed to. At the very bottom, it also tells us the image that was used, the sprite sheet PNG. Okay, heading on back in here. Not that one, this one. So you can get a pro version and it's roughly the same. You can read about that if you want. Here are the two files that we're listing as assets in an array. That's a list of something. The path is asset slash, that's to the folder. And then we pass those two right here into a frame. So this is Zim, making it's a framework. And we're using a fit mode, which means they'll fit into that browser window. You want to see that? Which one was it? There it is. So as I squeeze this, you see the blue bit. The blue bit is the frame. And indeed, if you look back here, the blue bit is the color of the frame, or the what we call the stage as well. Frame makes a stage for us. And the pink bit is on the outside. So as we stretch the window, you can see that the frame fits within the browser window. That's a little bit different than this one. Well, it's quite a bit different, I suppose. This one is embedded right in the HTML. So this is all HTML code, all this stuff. And the canvas is just this little bit right here with the animation embedded in it. So you can do it in two different ways that way. You can also make it fill the whole window. We use a lot for mobile apps. But anyway, we're going to show you how to fit, how to put it into a tag like this. And we're also going to show you how to do the fit mode like that, or indeed like this one too is a fit mode. See how that fits into the screen. Okay, popping on back. We said that's how big it is, those are our colors, and when we're ready, we'll call this function right here. So when it loads the assets and makes the stage and fits it into the window, it's ready. And here we are making a new sprite. We're passing it the JSON file right there. And since the JSON file has the image in it, it knows where the image is, and that's all we need to tell the sprite, and then it can find that. And then we're going to center it on the stage and run it for a time of 0.4 seconds. If we ran it for 0.2 seconds, it would be twice as fast. If we ran it for 1 second, it would look like it's slower. So that's up to you to decide how quickly to run that, and we're making it loop. So there you go. That's the sprite. The rest of it is just to make that little Zim icon at the bottom right, right down here, Zim icon, and this message right here with a link that opens up to the texture packer. So there are the words, and we have a link on it. We tap that, and we go to the texture packer site. So don't worry about those things. Those are a little extra. We are concerned about the sprite here. That sprite's not interactive either. So what I want to do though is I'll take you into the zip file that's there, and I can show you a little bit about how to view this in a browser and get all set up. Okay, so the zip file is up here for me. Let's see, where is it? There she be. So examples.zip, and you can find it yourself at the interactive animation page. Scroll on down, and there's a link to the zip file right there. So the zip file has a sprite.html page and an interactive.html page. It's all in the examples here. And then it also has an assets folder that has the various pictures that are in that one of the space guy with the backgrounds. It also has the sprites for the Dr. Abstract pointing, and so that's there as well, all this stuff. Let's go in and take a look at the sprite one right here. So here's the sprite one, and it starts off, so here it is, it starts off with information about how you can view files. So that's good to know. Normally, you can just pick up the file from your folder. You've got it in a folder on your desktop somewhere or wherever. You can just pick it up and drop it onto a browser. And that's how we normally would look at HTML files locally on our own computer. You can also double click the HTML file and it'll probably open up in a browser, your default browser, such as Chrome, Firefox, Safari, etc. But when you view Canvas files locally, like on your own computer, there's a security error when trying to view images on the canvas that's called a tainted canvas. It's for all canvas things. It's not just Zim. And they don't want you getting viruses from pictures that you, whatever. We're professionals, so we don't worry about that. And there's a way around it. You just have to tell the browser not to worry about that. And if once you post it on the server for other people to look at in the world, then they don't have that security error. It's fine being shown over a server. It's just when you're viewing them locally. So on Chrome, you would make a shortcut for Chrome and put it on your desktop, for instance, and then click and choose properties, right click and choose properties. Under the target, you'll see something probably like this with quotes around it. And what you need to do to make it run so that we don't get the error is add this flag to the end here. It starts off with a space, followed by two dashes, allow file access from files. Then you want to start your browser from that shortcut. So you have to close all your browsers and start it from the shortcut. And that means your Chrome will not worry about the fact that you're looking at local files. On Firefox, something similar, mac.onChrome, or on Chrome, on Mac, you open a terminal and paste that into it. And on Safari, you open up the browser, click on Develop in the menu up top, and then in the drop-down, select Disable Local File Restrictions. And from then on, you won't have these errors. All right, that's just to protect the innocent. Whatever. All right, then we have some information on making the sprite sheet. That's the same information as we already read before. Here we've got the Dr. Abstract PNG. Let's take a look. Here it is right there. Double click it. Oh, hang on. Why isn't it showing? Dr. Abstract PNG. Close it down. There we go. So that's the Dr. Abstract PNG locally. And we've got the sprite sheet for that is probably right here, Dr. Abstract JSON. With this file versus the other file, notice that the frames are kind of tighter like that. Like that's four frames right there. Whereas in our other sprite sheet, this whole thing is actually just four frames. So they're different formats. This is one frame, here's a second frame. And so they're just spaced out the information a bit more. So this is a different format. We exported this from the pro version, and this is exported in the easel.js format, create.js, easel.js. Zim was built on create.js and easel.js. So we tended to use this one. The other one works as well, though. And down or up above here, we have the image as well as the various frames. Okay, so we were looking at the sprite version. There they are. So we're bringing in these. We import them as well here. And this one's a little bit different. Why don't we look at it? There's another way to look at files. So I showed you how you could, told you how you could drop a file into a browser and open it up that way. But you have to set up those files to allow file access. That's fine. Another way to do it is under packages here in Atom anyway, there's the settings view. So if we open up settings view, then we can see we can install or choose install. You could have chosen install. We can install a package that allows us to open the animation or the HTML page right in Atom. And there's another package as well. So you hit install, and these are the packages that you'll want. You'll want the Browser Plus one. I already have it. So Browser Plus opens it right in Atom. And then the other one that you'll want to get is Open in Browser. It's a package which allows you to just quickly open it up in a browser. And let me show you how that works. So if I right click here, I can open it up in a browser. Bing. And there is opening up in a browser. So one sec. I actually had the error because I must not have opened my browser from here. So I should have shown you the error. Huh? Open in browser. Yeah, there we go. Now I see the image. So if I didn't start Chrome browsers with that shortcut, if I started them instead from, say, Atom like this, then I might run into an error. The other one is right click here and sit open in browser plus, or say open in browser plus. And there it opens right up in Browser Plus. And Browser Plus doesn't have the security problems. Okay, so when I'm teaching this, often we're just here in Browser Plus and we don't get the security errors, but we've now shown you how to avoid those. Remember, this is all local. You see how it's my local file here? File local, it's not on the server. On the server, you don't run into these issues. Okay, so there it is. And note that this is an HTML page. So that's HTML. This is the canvas right here. And this is more HTML. So we want to put the Zim page, the canvas, into a tag. So if we look on down here in the HTML, this is our body. And that's where HTML shows up. So anything in the body shows up on the page here. There's our heading for a sprite embedded in HTML. That's this. And then here's our div, a division, a div tag with an ID of animation just sitting there. And that's where Zim will put the canvas. And then we can call this anything we want, and we'll just hook it up above, as I'll show you. And then here's more HTML. So if this were your portfolio, you would put a tag in there. And then up above here, I'll show you how we hook that up. When we make the new frame, we just put the ID of the tag. Okay, so if we called this first or something like that, where'd it go? We called that first because we wanted several of them, then we would have to call this first. And if we wanted several of them, we can make a new frame and call it something else, and we go into a different tag. So we're making the animation that big, or the frame that big. That's actually how big the frame of the animation is. So this is the what we call the stage, and or stage width, stage height. This is the color of it. And our animator didn't make it background transparent. This is Antonio who made these. Thank you very much, Antonio from Sheridan, and did a great job on them all. This one, he forgot to make the background transparent, so we're stuck with this gray color. So you should make your sprite backgrounds transparent, most likely, and you'll be able to place it more places easily. This is the color of the outer thing. And if you're embedding it on an HTML page, you don't want to change that to say something like red. Here's what would happen. So now this red right here is the outer color outside, and it's turned the whole HTML page red. So if you just put in null, then it will just take whatever the HTML color is, this color right here, the background color of the body, set in CSS. So there's the function to call when it's ready, and there's the assets in the path, just like before. And the frame's pretty well like before too, or sorry, the sprite is. New sprite, we say what JSON file to load, and again, that JSON file has the image in it. We're just adding it to the stage rather than centering it because it's the same size as the stage, so we could have centered it or whatever. And then there we are running it for a time of 3.5. We've got rewind true. We're waiting 5 seconds after, as it rewinds, just before it rewinds. Then we loop, and then we wait 5 seconds to go back. So that's what's happening there. You don't really need all that stuff, but there you go. Down below, we provided a bit of CSS to style that, so it's centered here in this gray box. You can look over that CSS. I don't really want to go over the CSS right now, but that's it. Maybe. This stuff in here would allow you to make a fixed width, for instance. Now we're setting it to a smaller width in there. That's one way to do it. We could have made this smaller up here too, I suppose. anyway, that would work. If you did make this smaller right here, then the sprite would be too big, and we would have to scale the sprite .ska, which isn't a problem. We could go 0.5 if we made that half as big, for instance, and that easily allows us to scale it. Or we can scale to the stage, and just no matter what size we make in the stage, we could have, it would have scale to, would have put it the full size there. But you can do that. If you make it bigger, like 800, then you might run into problems. It'll look a little bit blurry. Note that this is also not responsive, really. It always stays the same size, no matter how big the window. So this other one right here shows us how you could make it responsive if you want, like so. And this is 90% of the width, which is a little bit awkward for. So, and it has a max width of 500 pixels. So that's reached the max width of 500 pixels. And then as we make it smaller, it gets smaller to 90% of whatever is available. So that will work on mobile or on a tablet if you so desire, something like that. Okay. It's a little bit awkward for a square shape. Really, that would be better if you had a scene that was relatively wide. Then it would fit nicely as you went along there. Okay, so that's that example where it's embedded in a website. And so now what we're going to take a look at is the interactive example. So here it is here. And we can refresh our memory as to what that looked like by saying show open in Browser Plus. And there it is in Browser Plus with the shooting. Okay. The same deal with viewing files and the same deal with importing or making the sprite sheet. This time we've got more things that we're bringing in. We're bringing in the sprite sheet PNG and sprite sheet JSON. So that's, here's the PNG. Ooh, look at that. So there's Texturepacker doing its job, making the skinny ones packed in skinny and making the fatter ones. Yeah. So that's what Texturepacker's doing. And then the Texturepacker JSON file for that, same thing. There's the sprite sheet. Oh, we did add one thing. So here's what came with it. And then we added animation specifically so that we have a walk cycle and a shoot cycle. So if you look at the sprite sheet again, all of these ones, all the way to here are the walk cycle. And then from here on is the shoot cycle. So we went into this and we added a comma, and then animations have the following. And if we wanted to stop, that's a good frame to stop on for this animation. So that if we run stop, it would just run there, stand 5. If we run walk, it'll run 0 to 16. Remember that it starts at 0, so that's frame 0. And then when we shoot, we want 17 to 24. If you wanted to take this code right here, like our custom animations, and add it to the format of the other sprite sheet, so this is that free format sprite sheet thing, okay, we would go, you see how it says frames there? We keep on going down, 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 and now that's the end of the frames, and we have a comma, and there's meta. So we could just put it right in here, animations, just like meta, but we need a comma after, so comma. So now it's comma, animations, comma, meta. Or you could take it right from here, cut that. So here's how it was, boop, 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 boop. And we could paste a comma or put a comma here and paste it at the end, get rid of that comma. So now we have comma, meta, comma, animations held in there. And that would be fine. That would work in that sprite format. Okay, we also are bringing in the ground, the foreground. So these are some images. They're all available here. So here is the background, for instance. Where is it? Background. Okay, that's the background of it and the foreground, etc. As well as the shoot and sneak. Shoot and sneak MP3s. So this is an array. It's a list of things. In this case, a list of strings with quotes there with commas between them. And it doesn't matter if we go on to the next lines there. There's our path of assets. All that stuff is in assets. Here's interactive. So assets is in the same folder. All this stuff is in examples. Assets is there, interactive. So Then we have decided that since we have so many pictures and images and sounds, that on slower internet speeds, we might want to provide some sort of indication that things are loading. So we can use a Zim Waiter. It looks like that. There we are setting the background color in the corner on it. We've called it Progress. And down below, there's where we pass it in. So when we make our new frame, the fit mode this time, we provide some dimensions. We have some that's the color and the background color. When we're ready, we call ready. Here's the assets in the path like before. And then this is the progress bar, which is a waiter that goes doot, 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 sort of thing. We can make an actual progress bar. This is a round. By default, it's a round progress bar and it fills up. But if we specify the type here, we could make a rectangle and make a rectangular progress bar. But I think we're probably fine with just a waiter. Do you want to see what the waiter looks like? All right, let's open it up here. Doot, doot, doot. Oh, we have to find it. Yeah, so I have to go back to Zim, simjs.com, and AI, nope, IA, interactive animation. And we are testing this version. So watch as we load this version. You should see a waiter. I might have to refresh. There. Did you see it? Control refresh. Well, that only went once. So it goes dot, dot, dot. But my internet speed is so fast that we could hardly see it. So there we go. Fast internet speed. Yay. All righty. Okay. So when we're ready, we will be given a frame, a stage, a width, and a height. So we're given these little variables, F for the frame, S for the stage, W for the width of the stage and height. And we'll use these down below, I think, if I recall. Here's some more information on sprites, some more information on sprite sheets, and some information on dynamic sprite creation. So we're going to make a sprite that changes speed. Dum, dum, dum. Let's pull it up here and have a look at that again. So see that? Slow sprite, fast sprite, and shooting sprite. And the backgrounds are also going as well. So we've got to control those backgrounds. So that's some information on how we're doing all of that. How we're doing all of that. Good. Here's our sprite. So we're making a new sprite. We're passing in the sprite sheet JSON. We're center regging this time rather than just centering it or adding to. The center reg will center what's called the registration point of the sprite. And that's because we're flipping the sprite. We're going left and right and flipping the sprite. So we want it to flip around its center. And where it will flip about is its registration point. By default, a sprite has its registration point at the top left corner. So by center regging it, it will put that registration point in the center and flip properly. We're also moving it down because we want the sprite to be down there at the bottom. Okay, so when we flip, see how it flips about the center? I almost can't tell. We could move the sprite right over to the middle of the body right now. It's the gun is affecting it a little bit, but whatever. We could do that with what's called reg. By moving 110, that moves it down. So down is actually positive on the stage here in interactive media. Next, we're going to turn that sprite into a dynamic sprite by adding it to a Dynamo. So note that we haven't even run the sprite here like we did before in those other examples. We just made a new Dynamo. We passed in the sprite, said what the default speed is, and said what label to do. And so here's our walk label. Yay! And we made it reversible false. So what reversible true would do, which is the default, what reversible true would do is as it speeds up, it will go faster forward. But if the speed goes negative, it will reverse the animation. So the animation will actually run backwards. Well, we don't want the animation to run backwards. What we want to do is have it flip. So there it is going forward. But when our speed goes backwards, which is now, instead of the animation walking backwards, which is what would happen if it were reversible, it flips and then still goes forward, but flipped. All right, so by default, the flip will be, so we could add flip here, colon true, But if it's reversible false, we assume you want to flip it, and therefore we don't really need to add that. Okay, so we've got this sprite that is now dynamic. We can adjust the speeds of it. And the way we do that, we could adjust the speed with just saying dynamo.percent speed equals point, equals 50. 50% speed would make it half as speed. And we can control that with different things like sliders and stuff. But what we're going to do is we're going to end up controlling it with the mouse. And we don't only want to control the sprite, we actually want to control the backgrounds as well. So as the sprite slows down, we want the backgrounds to slow down and speed up. Do you remember how that works? So there it is going fast backwards. If I change direction, the backgrounds go in a different direction. If I slow it down, the backgrounds and foregrounds, I guess, all those things speed up and slow down with the sprite. So the way we do that is by putting them all into an accelerator. So we're going to make a new accelerator and start with by adding the dynamo. Then down below, we're going to make all of our backgrounds. So here's our scrollers for our backgrounds. We're adding the pictures of the backgrounds there. And the tricky thing is, three of those pictures are supposed to be underneath the sprite, and one of those pictures is supposed to be on top of the sprite. And the way a scroller works, by the way, is it takes the picture, it duplicates the picture, puts them next to one another, and then as it scrolls across the screen, when it needs to, like when one picture goes all the way off the screen, then it swaps it and puts it back on the other end of the second picture, and it keeps swapping, and that way it looks like it scrolls forever. cool, huh? But anyway, we want three of them to be underneath the sprite. We want one of them to be on top. So what we'll do is we'll put the three from underneath into this container called backings. So you see how we've add to backings. And backings is a container that's the same size as the stage, the width and height of the stage. We've added it to the stage at level zero. So at level zero or layer zero. In other words, it goes underneath the sprite. We could have done it this way, .bot, which would just pick it up and put it at the bottom, but this is also, I suppose this is shorter. All right, so we've added the container that holds those three backings to the stage, S, at level zero or layer zero. This one just got added to, just gets added to the stage, and it will go on top of the sprite. We did move these, a couple of these we moved. These other ones right here, the 1, 3, 2, and 5, they're part of the scroller. So look, this is the back, this is the picture, all to do with the picture. This one's all to do with the picture, but this second one here is the speed of the scroller. So we're going to have the first scroller, the backing will just go at one speed. The ground will go faster than that, and the mid, that's just a stacking level. We wanted the ground to be out front, but we still want it to be faster. And then the very front, the foreground, is going the fastest right there. So that's us setting the default speeds of the scrollers. All of these scrollers right here are being added to the accelerator. So we put them into an array and added them to the accelerator. We could have probably just taken the dynamo and just added it right in there as well. Dynamo, but comma. So that would be us adding the dynamo to the accelerator plus these things. And we wouldn't need that part right there, but whatever. It doesn't matter too much. Okay, so we have an accelerator, but what controls this accelerator? The accelerator is kind of cool because if we change the accelerator's percent speed, everything in the accelerator will change. That's why we're doing this. We can control a single accelerator and control the whole scene. And we're controlling the whole scene with a motion controller. So this is the Zim motion controller. We're saying, please make the target the accelerator. So that's what we're targeting. And we're going to use the mouse move. We could also use a press move. We could use a key down. We could use a game stick, etc. So there's other ones that you can use as well. But basically, whenever we move our mouse, and this will work for if you've got a mobile device, just putting your finger on the screen will move the mouse. So it's okay. We're making it horizontal only and setting a speed. This is the speed of the controller of 100. That means Well, usually a controller is controlling something like a ball or something. So it's moving the ball at a certain speed. Well, this is going to move the accelerator at that speed. And then what this is doing is if we provide a min percent speed and a max percent speed, this is percentage. So 200% means twice as fast as that. Minus 200% is minus twice as fast as that. So over on the left-hand side, when we put our mouse on the left-hand side of the screen, it goes twice as fast as 100. So that's 200. If we put it in the middle, it goes zero. If we put it on the right, 0%. If we put it on the right, it goes 200% that. So it sort of divides up from negative 200 to 200. Twice as fast here, twice as fast here, zero speed in the middle. That would be about one times as fast. So that would have been the speed of 100, something like that. Twice as fast. Isn't that cool? What if you wanted to see it go even faster? So that would be something like 400 and 400. We'll have to open it up locally here. Open in browser plus. Now, look at that guy go. Okay, it's a little harder to control because it's kind of whipping around all over the place. It's a bit hyper. Maybe if it was flying, that would be good. But it's just a little bit too fast for us. So we'll put it back to 200 here. The other thing is, if we didn't do this little step here, this little magical step, watch what happens. It was kind of like a scratching our head going, oh, geez. So the motion controller only works when we put the cursor in the stage here. So this picture is the stage. So we'll refresh that again. See, if the cursor is not in the stage, then we're stuck with this guy. Ignore these things. Jeez, go away. We're stuck with this guy who's hiding behind the pole. It's like, ah! So we could rearrange the foreground so that it starts there or something like that. But what we did is we tricked it a little bit. We told the motion controller to think that the X position of the mouse was at 700. So that's about right here, somewhere like that, 700, because this whole width is whatever the width is, 1024, I think. So the whole width is 1024, 700 would be somewhere in here. So basically, if we say X 700, that's about how fast we're going to start the man. So you ready? We refresh. Oh, I didn't save it. So there's the saving. So there it is stuck. We refresh. And there it is. That's the man walking. Okay. We could have made it start off faster by saying 1,000 or something. And that would be just like putting the cursor over there at the 2x speed. And if we said 0, what would it be? Can you figure it? It'd start going backwards, the 2x speed. All right. But we like 700. Oh, 700. Good. How are you guys doing out there? I hope all right. We have one last little bit, and that's the shooting. Yeah, let's shoot it. So this is now making the man shoot like that, and he's going to shoot a random number of times. Let's see how we did that then. Just close this for now. It's hard sometimes thinking and talking when this thing is animating next to me. Have it actually animating over in another window as well. All right, so shooting. We have a shoot sound, MP3, and we've already loaded the shoot sound up here. So we preloaded it. Although it'd work without preloading too, I think, but it's a good idea to preload. There's our shoot sounds. Right there, loading in. And down below, we make a new odd from that, or audio. We have a new pick, we have a new odd, we have a new vid, we have a new SVG. Those are some of the assets that we can bring in. Also text and JSON, just as assets. So there's a new odd. Here we are setting the volume on it, and we've put that in shoot sound. That won't play it. That just has it ready for us in shoot sound. Then we're going to capture a mouse down on the backings and on the sprite. We did put a mouse down on the stage, or it's actually called a stage mouse down, stage.on stage mouse down. But then, see, we have this little bit right here, right there. This is also on the stage, so when we went to add the music, it went pew and shot. So we went, oh, darn. So really, we only put the shoot on the backing there and on the person. We need to put it on the person as well, of course, because we want to put it on the person if we press the person. So that's this, the person, the sprite. Here's the backings. When we mouse down, this is the function that we want to call, a function called shoot. So here's the function shoot down here. Also, when we key down, we are calling this function when we key down. If the key code is 32, we actually want to call the function shoot. This is us defining which function to call when we hit the backing or the sprite. But this is us, when we key down, we actually do want to run the function. So that will run the function shoot. Don't worry if you don't get that. Come to interactive media at Sheridan, and we'll teach it to you in a year's worth. You'll become experts. So the other thing about shooting is we don't want to shoot if we're already shooting, because that would allow us to press, or hit the space bar. We hit the space bar when you shoot, it would like constantly shoot. So do you want to see what that would be like? I'm going to comment out the if shooting. Oops. And let's try it, see what happens. Open in browser. Oh, I won't open in browser. I will open in browser plus. And are you ready? Oh my goodness, that's quite the machine gun. Okay, I hope you heard that. So we don't want that to happen. We want to shoot, yes, but so what we do is we have this variable. It's like a check variable. Let shooting equals false. Currently, we're not shooting. Then, if we're not shooting, that's what this means, if we're not shooting, go ahead and shoot. This is the stuff that is all the shooting. And while we're at it, we are going to say, well, now that we're shooting, we're going to set shooting equal true. So that means if we try and press down again, and we're already shooting, the next time it comes in, shooting will be true. So it will run the function shoot, and it will say, if it's not shooting, do this. But if shooting's true, it won't do this. So that's the idea. Anyway, that's programming logic. That's one of the tricky bits about programming is when you start to apply logic like that. We are also going to pause the accelerator. And that means the motion pauses as we're shooting. Did you notice that? So here we go. It's moving. I shoot. And then it goes again. Isn't that cool? I don't even have to do anything. Shoot. And then it goes again. So let's see how we did that. Well, there's us pausing the accelerator, and then we play the shoot sound. Yay! So we save the shoot sound up here, and now we're playing it. And here we run the sprite, because the sprite has been paused, the accelerator has been paused, but here we are running the sprite directly, and we are going to run the label shoot. So that's how we can specify the shoot cycle. In this amount of time, we're going to loop. And here's that loop count random between 1 and 3. So if I said 2 there, can you imagine what will happen? Open in browser plus. Shoot. 1, 2. Shoot again. 1, 2. Shoot this way. 1, 2. So that will always just shoot twice. So rand between 1 and 3, we'll do 1, 2, or 3. Yay. When the loop is finished, we play the shoot sound. So we play the shoot sound at the beginning, then as it's looping, we play it every time it loops, including the last time. I think including the last time. Yeah, I'm not sure. Maybe not. No, not including the last time. When it ends, it does a call. So when it ends, we set the shooting to false because we're done shooting now. Yay! So it will call. This is the call at the end of the animation, however many times we loop. So we end our shooting, we unpause the accelerator. We say accelerator pause, false. That will turn the accelerator back on and it starts animating again. Woohoo! So some custom looking code, some mouse downs. This is how we do interactive media. We call a function when an event happens, like when we click on a button or when we move over something or hover over something or when something's loaded. We always call events when these things are happening. Okay, there's a label credit that comes in. This is the animation that is not a sprite. This is how we do it with a Zim animate. We're making this container that are the credits. So what we're looking at now is if I refresh here, watch this stuff that comes in at the top here. That animated in, we've got a couple words here in boxes, animator Antonio, hey, and we can click that and go to Antonio's site as well. So let's see how we did that. We located it off the stage. So it starts off negative 500 in the X, and then we animate the X property into 150 in a certain amount of time. We don't do it right away, because watch what happens if it runs right away. You ready? We open in browser plus here. comes in right away. Well, we're trying to look at the animation here. I want you to see the animation, not this thing coming in. So it's a bit of a conflict. It's like, which one am I looking at? This animating in or that? So the wait allows us to concentrate on the animation of this fellow and then see this come in a little bit later. And eventually it will go out. Watch how it comes in though. You ready? And goes out, as a matter of fact. It comes in too far and goes back. And then when it goes out and then goes away. Isn't that cool? So that's called a back. That's an ease, a back out. We have other eases too, like a bounce. So it makes it bounce. We've got an elastic as well. And rewinds and rewind waits. That's why it was waiting 5 seconds. We also have a tap and we go. But this isn't really to do with the sprite animation. It just shows you how easy it is to animate in Zim in general. These are the labels that we put into that container, the credit container. So here's the credit container, so it can hold both these labels. We put different backings on those labels, and we skewed them and added them both to that container at different locations. Both of these are align center and V align center and color white, so we separated that out in Zim style. We're the only canvas framework that I know of that has style, just like CSS. So that's quite robust, and we end our style. Isn't that neat? The backing sound, by the way, you can't play a sound until the user interacts. So it's fine for shooting, but that's why we had to put the sound in a toggle here. And then when we press the toggle, we play the sound. So you can kind of read through that, but that's how we did our backing sound. And that is it. Isn't that amazing? So that was a take through of the interactive works there. What I'd like to show you now maybe is that if you have any questions with this, I'm going to just do a bit of desktop reveal. You can come join us at Slack. Slack is our official place where we do support. So these are people that have been asking questions, and then we go ahead and we answer the questions with replies and threads and stuff. There's also various information on releases that we're releasing, etc., and different channels. So that's the Zim Slack. Please come on in, join us. There's about 600 people here. Join us. It would be lovely to see you there. And then this is the Zim Discord right here, where it's much the same. You've got the Discord people hanging out and chatting. So whichever one you want, and I'd be happy to take you into a text chat or like a voice chat even, or video chat if you need some help in what you're doing there. So I am Dr. Abstract. This fellow here, let's see, where were we? We'll be back in there. Now that's Google. This, I don't know how to get back. Ah, here we are. We are on this page. Yeah. So I'm Dr. Abstract. This little fellow right here, we saw how to easily add a sprite animation to the page. By the way, that's like half the size of many frameworks, just getting that sprite on there. Really, really concise. And then here's Zim right here. So zimjs.com. You're welcome to come to zimjs.com. Have a look around, code creativity. These are things that Zim is great for making art, for making games, interactive logos, UI, UX. We've got a lot of exciting UI, UX, puzzles, e-learning apps, infoactives. All right, and if you press on any of these, you can find more information. So there's lots of animation going on in there and sprites and tons of examples of all animations and sprites and blobbity 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 blah. Okay, with games, there's a collection on motion controllers, for instance, to see there's a sprite right there, the butterfly. It's following the mouse move. Here's mouse down. That means it doesn't move until I mouse down, and then it will follow on a mouse down. Key moves, there we are moving with keys, keyboards, game buttons, etc. Okay, so there's all sorts of things to find here. We use sprites extensively in this virtual reality example. Watch that. That's the waiter. Look, there's a waiter. Woohoo! And then what we're doing here is doing parallax. So this is a big sort of parallax thing where did you see that sprite animate in there? And if we go back, there it's animating back and one step here and we're into this bit. So let me animate in again. And there she is, and we animate to the next one, prop, and she goes, yay! So we're doing that. As I scroll down, we see more animations coming in, and there's Dr. Abstract wearing a VR helmet, and he's going, oh my goodness, look at that. And so there's an interactive sprite to help us on our journey here. What do you think? And I'm just going to go all the way back to the beginning. Rump, 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 reep, woo, wah, wee. So you can use animated sprites. This is a different type of animation here, but you can use animated sprites in websites such as that. And we do. Alrighty, well, why don't we leave it at that? Thank you very much for being here. I hope that you're successful in putting a sprite onto your desktop or onto your web page. And thanks again to Antonio for making these wonderful sprites as well, and our space guy. We'll catch you guys later. I am Dr. Abstract here at zimjs.com. Cheers.